Time Warner Audiobooks presents White Oleander, written by Janet Fitch and performed by Oprah Winfrey.
The Santa Anas blew in hot from the desert, shriveling the last of the spring grass into whiskers of pale straw. Only the oleanders thrived, their delicate poisonous blooms, their dagger green leaves. We could not sleep in the hot, dry nights, my mother and I. I woke up at midnight to find her bed empty. I climbed to the roof and easily spotted her blonde hair, like a white flame in the light of the three-quarter moon. "Oleander time," she said. "Lovers who kill each other now will blame it on the wind." She held up her large hand and spread the fingers, let the desert dryness lick through. My mother was not herself in the time of the Santa Anas. I was 12 years old, and I was afraid for her. I wish things were back the way they had been, that Barry was still here, that the wind would stop blowing. "You should get some sleep," I offered. "I never sleep," she said. I sat next to her and we stared out at the city that hummed and glittered like a computer chip deep in some unknowable machine, holding its secret like a poker hand. The edge of her white kimono flapped open in the wind and I could see her breast, low and full. Her beauty was like the edge of a very sharp knife. I rested my head on her leg. She smelled like violets. "We are the wands," she said. "We strive for beauty and balance, the sensual over the sentimental." "The wands," I repeated. I wanted her to know I was listening. Our tarot suit the wands. She used to lay out the cards for me, explain the suits, wands and coins, cups and swords. But she'd stop reading them. She didn't want to know the future anymore. "We received our coloring from Norsemen," she said. "Hairy savages who hacked their gods to pieces and hung the flesh from trees. We are the ones who sacked Rome, fear only feeble old age and death in bed. Don't forget who you are." "I promise," I said. Down below us in the streets of Hollywood, sirens whined and sawed along my nerves. In the Santa Anas, eucalyptus trees burst into flames like giant candles, and oil-fat chaparral hillsides went up in a rush, flushing starved coyotes and deer down onto Franklin Avenue. She lifted her face to the singed moon, bathing in its glowering beams. "Raven's eye moon." "Babyface moon," I countered, my head on her knee. She softly stroked my hair. "It's a traitor's moon." In the spring, this wound had been unimaginable, this madness. But it had lain before us, undetectable as a landmine. We didn't even know the name Barry Colker then. Barry. When he appeared, he was so small. Smaller than a comma. Insignificant as a cough. Someone she met at a poetry reading. It was at a wine garden in Venice. As always when she read, my mother wore white and her hair was the color of new snow against her lightly tanned skin. She stood in the shade of a massive fig tree, its leaves like hands. I sat at the table behind stacks of books I was supposed to sell after the reading, slim books published by the Blue Shoe Press of Austin, Texas. After the reading, people crowded around, gave me money to put in the cigar box. My mother signed a few books. "Ah, the writer's life," she said ironically, as they handed me the crumpled fives and ones. But she loved these readings the way she loved evenings with her writer friends, trashing famous poets over a drink and a joint, and hated them. The way she hated the lousy job she had at Cinema Scene magazine, where she pasted up the copy of other writers who, at 50 cents a word, bled shameless cliches, stock nouns, and slack verbs, while my mother could agonize for hours over whether to write an or the. As she signed her books, she wore her customary half-smile, more internal than outward, having a private joke while she thanked everybody for coming. I knew she was waiting for a certain man. I'd already seen him, a shy blonde in a tank top with a bead and yarn necklace, who stood in the back, watching her, helpless, intoxicated. After 12 years as Ingrid's daughter, I could spot them in my sleep. A chunky man, his dark hair pulled back in a curly ponytail, pushed in, offered his book to be signed. Barry Kolker, love your work. She signed his book, handed it back to him, not even looking into his face. What are you doing after the reading? He asked. I have a date, she said, reaching for the next book to sign. After that, he said. And I liked his self-confidence, though he wasn't her type, being chubby, dark, and dressed in a suit from the Salvation Army. All that summer, I went with her to the magazine. She never thought far enough ahead to put me in a Y program, and I never mentioned the possibility of summer school. I enjoyed school itself, but it was torture for me to try to fit in as a girl among other girls. Girls my own age were a different species entirely. Their concerns as foreign as the Doggins of Mali. Seventh grade had been particularly painful, and I waited for the moment I could be with my mother again. The art room of CinemaScene, with its ink pens and a carousel of colored pencils, table-sized paper, overlays and bendé dots, border tape, and discarded headlines and photographs that I could wax and collage, was my paradise. I liked the way the adults talked around me. They forgot I was there and said the most amazing things. Today, the writers and the art director, Marlene, gossiped about the affair between the publisher and the editor of the magazine. A bizarre bit of Santa Ana madness, my mother commented from the paste-up table. That beaky anorexic and the toupee chihuahua, it's beyond grotesque. Their children wouldn't know whether to peck or bark. They laughed. My mother was the one who would say out loud what the others were thinking. I sat at the empty drafting table next to my mother's, drawing the way the Venetian blinds sliced the light like cheese. I waited to hear what my mother would say next, but she put her headphones back on, like a period at the end of a sentence. This was how she paced it up, listening to exotic music over headphones and pretending she was far away in some scented kingdom of fire and shadows, instead of sitting at a drafting table at a movie magazine, pasting up actor interviews for $8 an hour. That night, she went out by herself. I drew for an hour, ate a peanut butter and mayonnaise sandwich, then drifted down to Michael's, knocked on the hollow door. Three bolts fell back. It's Queen Christina. He smiled, a gentle, soft man, about my mother's age, but puffy and pale from drinking and being inside all the time. The apartment was very different from ours, crammed with furniture and souvenirs and movie posters, variety and newspapers and empty wine bottles, tomato plants straggling on the windowsills, groping for a little light. Snow again, he said along with Garbo, tilting his face up like hers. Eternal snow. He handed me a bowl of sunflower seeds. I am Garbo. I cracked seeds in my teeth and flicked off the rubber sandals I'd been wearing since April. I couldn't tell my mother I'd outgrown my shoes again. I didn't want to remind her that I was the reason she was trapped in electric bills and kids' shoes grown too small, the reason she was clawing at the windows like Michael's dying tomatoes. She was a beautiful woman, dragging a crippled foot, and I was that foot. I was bricks sewn into the hem of her clothes. I was a steel dress. We both turned to the TV to catch the best line in Queen Christina, saying along with Garbo, "The snow is like a white sea. One could go out and be lost in it and forget the world." I thought of my mother as Queen Christina, cool and sad, eyes trained on some distant horizon. That was where she belonged, in furs and palaces of rare treasures, fireplaces large enough to roast a reindeer, ships of Swedish maple. My deepest fear was that someday she would find her way back there and never return. It was why I always waited up when she went out on nights like this, no matter how late she came home. I had to hear her key in the lock, smell her violet perfume again. And I tried not to make it worse by asking for things, pulling her down with my thoughts. I had seen girls clamor for new clothes and complain about what their mothers made for dinner. I was always mortified. Didn't they know? They were tying their mothers to the ground? Weren't chains ashamed of their prisoners? But how I envied the way their mothers sat on their beds and asked what they were thinking. My mother was not in the least bit curious about me. I often wondered what she thought I was. A dog she could tie in front of the store?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.